Debian provides the base of many different Linux distributions, including Ubuntu. However, just because Ubuntu is based on Debian, it does not mean they are the same, and in this video I will explain the differences between the two distributions. Debian was founded in 1993 by the late Ian Murdoch. Funding comes from selling commercial support and community donations. Ubuntu was founded in 2004 by Canonical. The funding model is the same as Debian, with selling commercial support and community donations. Debian focuses on stability, rather than being at the bleeding edge, as evidenced by the fact in 24 years they've only reached version 8.7 at time of recording, with version 9 imminent. There are three active releases of Debian. Stable, which is currently named Wheezy, is the official production release of Debian. Testing, which is currently named Stretch, is what will become the future stable release. No release date is set, as Debian will only release when they consider it to be stable enough. Unstable, or SID, is where most of the development work is done. SID will never get released, it is just a rolling development version of Debian. If you hadn't realised, the names come from characters in the movie Toy Story. Security updates are provided in a timely manner to testing and stable, however, SID may lag behind. In terms of architecture, Debian is available in 32 and 64-bit, as well as ARM. There are three different ISO files for system installation: Net Installer, Live Image, and a larger Complete Installation ISO for anyone without an internet connection. The default desktop for Debian is Gnome, although many of the other popular desktops are available as official flavours, including Cinnamon, KDE, LXDE, Mate, and XFCE. I will point out the focus with Debian is most certainly with the Gnome desktop, and is particularly evidenced with the lower quality builds of the KDE desktop. I don't find it to be such a problem with the unofficial KDE-specific distributions based on Debian. For example, Solid K, but it could well be to do with a point which I brought up in my Ubuntu vs Arch video in regards to packaging and dependency quality. Ubuntu operates on a fixed release schedule of once every 6 months, with long-term support releases once every 2 years. The interim releases are supported for just 9 months, and the LTS releases are supported for 5 years, with optional pay-for support to extend further. There is an official upgrade path between releases of Ubuntu, with the preference being to retain users on the LTS releases. Ubuntu offer 4 official variants: Ubuntu Desktop, Server, Net Install, and Snappy Core, which is for the Internet of Things. The default desktop for Ubuntu is now Gnome, and although we have not seen a release yet, I believe it will be a stock version of Gnome, just like Debian has. Prior to Ubuntu 17.10, the default desktop was Unity 7 for desktop systems and Unity 8 for mobile. However, Canonical have ended their venture into mobile convergence and reverted back to using the Gnome desktop for future releases. In terms of system architecture, Ubuntu is available in 32 and 64-bit, as well as ARM. There are several official derivatives of Ubuntu supported by Canonical, which increases the desktop selection up to Budgie, KDE, LXDE, Mate, and XFCE. Ubuntu have one up on Debian offering the Budgie desktop, however they lack the Cinnamon desktop in the official releases. Each release of Ubuntu starts life from Debian testing, and then is supported by Canonical for the life of the distribution. Ease of install. Both Debian and Ubuntu have an easy-to-use point-and-click graphical installer. Sudo behaviour. This is probably the most obvious difference between Debian and Ubuntu, and is more likely to affect users transitioning from Ubuntu to Debian rather than vice versa. Ubuntu have removed the root user and instead provide sudo writes to the user created at system install. In comparison, Debian have a root user, but have not given sudo writes to the user created at system install. What this means is if you want to elevate your privileges in Ubuntu, you simply type sudo and then the command, whereas doing that in Debian will put you on Santa's naughty list. By default, you have to use the command su to switch user to root in Debian. The switch is persistent until you exit. In comparison, sudo is a temporary elevation for a few minutes. Again, this difference in behaviour can cause an annoyance to anyone transitioning between the two systems. From a security point of view, removing the root user does make an Ubuntu system safer, as a hacker would have to guess both the user and password. Although it is possible to prevent logon to root with remote access tools such as SSH, which perhaps nullifies this advantage. The behaviour can be changed on each distribution to replicate the other, but as to what is really best, it comes down to a personal preference. Packaging. Both distributions at their core use deb packages, which can be installed via dpkg, apt, synaptic, or a desktop-specific package manager. It is possible to add third-party repositories to both Debian and Ubuntu. However, it is not always possible to add the same third-party repository to both distributions, due to conflicts in version numbers. Canonical provide Launchpad, an open-source project hosting service, which allows you to further expand the number of available applications to Ubuntu. Official advice is Launchpad PPAs should not be used in Debian. But hey, some rules are made to be broken. It has to be reviewed on a case-by-case basis as to whether it is possible to add a specific Launchpad PPA into Debian. Ubuntu also supports installation of snap-based applications, which come supplied with all their dependencies in one snap package, and are run in a sandboxed environment. Debian has only just gained the necessary snapd application in testing and SID, which is essential for installing snaps. There is no real winner here, as both distributions share the same packaging formats. Perhaps the only advantage goes to Ubuntu, in that there is a wider selection of third-party repositories to be installed from Launchpad. Choice of applications. Debian is dedicated to free software, as in free open source, and as a result, you have to enable the contrib and non-free sections from the repositories. Without the repository modifications, you will be unable to install proprietary audio and video codecs or proprietary firmware and drivers. Ubuntu do not seem to be bothered by the difference, and they enable the restricted proprietary software and multiverse copyright limited repositories out of the box. In my opinion, I want the best software, and I am not bothered whether it is open source or proprietary. The winner in this section is the distribution that best suits your personal ethics and standards. Bleeding edge, or lack of. Debian testing and SID are about as close as you can get to the bleeding edge. However, stable can be quite a long way behind. A little too distant, perhaps, for my liking, when I've had to deal with old desktops and programming for ancient versions of PHP and Python. Ubuntu has no bleeding edge version, unless you look at the derivative KDE Neon, which has a bleeding edge KDE desktop and applications. The regular release schedule of 6 months does mean the applications stay a little more up to date. For users of Ubuntu LTS releases, Canonical do provide newer kernels with the hardware enablement stack, which will provide support for CPUs and hardware which post-dated the release of the distribution. Upgrading. Ubuntu provide an official upgrade path between distributions with the preference to keep users on the LTS releases. Debian seems to be a bit more unofficial, as you have to manually edit the /etc/apt/sources.list file. In my experience, upgrades have been successful. However, I do have to say it is nowhere near as convenient as the point-and-click software updater in Ubuntu. Conclusion. Whichever way you look at it, there is simply no denying the fact that without Debian, there would be no Ubuntu. Actually, it would probably be based on something else. From what I have seen with other Linux distributions based on Debian, they tend to mimic the behaviour of Ubuntu with using sudo and enabling the install of proprietary software out of the box, which suggests to me the Ubuntu method is perhaps the preferred option for most users. I can't say the Debian method is necessarily wrong, more that it's different. Looking at the systems I have in my house, it is 3 Debian to 4 Ubuntu. I have 3 Raspberry Pis running Raspbian, 2 x86 servers running Ubuntu Server, a gaming system running Ubuntu, and my main desktop, which runs KDE Neon. Running Debian is definitely a progression for an Ubuntu user, as it requires slightly more command line usage. The long time between stable releases may be an issue, however it can be rectified by switching to the testing release of Debian. A new user could get by with Debian, but they may find it easier to utilise one of the distributions based on Debian. If you like my videos, then please consider being a Patreon and support Quidsup. You can pledge as little as $1 a month, or you can pledge a little bit more. Every little bit does help, and I really do appreciate it. Thank you all for watching, and as always, I will see you all later.